Thanks everyone for being here. Thanks everyone who is watching online as well. For those watching online, remember you can submit your questions via Twitter at Columbia U Energy with the hashtag CGEP Events, Center on Global Energy Policy, CGEP Events. My name is Jason Bordoff. I'm a faculty member here at Columbia School of International Public Affairs, the director of the Center on Global Energy Policy, and really delighted today to have Spencer Dale with us to discuss BP's new energy outlook. Those of you who follow the energy industry know there are a couple of notable annual forecasts that come out that people pay very close attention to, from the EIA, from the IEA, and the BP Global Energy Outlook. So given how rapidly the energy world is changing, the oil market and also beyond the oil market, the cost of renewables plummeting, changes in the global gas market and all the rest, it's really quite a timely moment to come together and hear Spencer's view, BP's view on what the energy market has in store, not just in the immediate near term, which I'm sure there'll be a lot of interest in, but also in the longer term. Those of you who've been with us before to see the release of the BP Outlook, you know we've done this before. We haven't had Spencer with us before. Spencer Dale joined BP in October of 2014 as the new group chief economist. Prior to that, was with the Bank of England as executive director for financial stability, a member of the Financial Policy Committee. Between 2008 and 2014, was a chief economist at the Bank of England and a member of the Monetary Policy Committee. He joined the Bank of England in 1989, serving in numerous roles, including private secretary to Mervyn King. So really is great to see him at BP now and in charge of these premier publications, and really delighted that he was able to travel to New York City to join the Center on Global Energy Policy at Columbia today. Please join me in welcoming Spencer Dale.
Jason, thank you for hosting today, and thank you everyone for sparing the time to come out today. I appreciate how busy everybody's lives are, so I really appreciate that. For those who are familiar with previous energy outlooks, you'll know they're sort of cram-packed full of sort of all sorts of data, analysis, insights, projections, and so the ability for me to sort of try and summarize that in 35 or 40 minutes is really hard. So what my plan is today is not to try and summarize it, but sort of essentially to whet your appetite. So I want to, the plan is to give you a few sort of, some idea of the sort of key out, some of the key trends, some of the key views in the outlook, with the hope that I'll whet your appetites and then you'll go away in your own time and delve into some of the more detailed analysis. So that's the plan. And I'll make sure that I don't go on for too long, so we have time also to then have a Q&A session as well. Because the real fun thing about coming out on the road and doing these talks is actually to have the interaction and to find out which bits of this story people find plausible and interesting and potentially important, but equally so, which bits do people just not buy and think we should be thinking in a slightly different way. Okay, to set the scene, we have the outlook looks over the next 20-odd years to 2035. And over that period of time, we see the level of global GDP roughly doubling over that period. Where does that growth in global GDP come from? Around a quarter of it comes from increases in population, and around three quarters from increase in productivity. So, and that's essentially a story of the less developing economies essentially moving, converging as they increasingly adopt best practice of the industrialized world. A significant proportion of that growth is concentrated within non-OECD Asia. So essentially what's driving that is China and India, which the non-OECD Asia accounts for around 60% of the growth in global GDP. So that's sort of the underlying economic backdrop underpinning the outlook. That sort of growth, that doubling in GDP, leads to an increase in energy demand of around 37%, so just shy of 40% increase in energy demand by 2035. that increase in energy demand is entirely driven by the non-OECD economies, so the less developed economies. You can see here in that bottom dark green swathe, the energy demand of the OECD economies, the developed economies, is essentially flat over the next 20 years. So the OECD economies clearly continue to grow over that period of time, but they also continue to make improvements in energy efficiency, and those two things broadly net out. This an increase in, of energy demand of just shy of 40% equates to an annual growth rate of around 1.5% on average over the next 20 years. That compares to a growth rate over the last 10 years or so of closer to 2.5%. So we see a slowing in the growth of energy demand over the next 20 years relative to the last 10 years. And that's driven to a very large extent by slowing in the energy growth of non-OECD Asia. And you can see this here on the right-hand side chart. So again here, for non-OECD Asia, you'll think China and India. Over the last 10 years or so, growth energy demand in China and India has been growing on average by a growth rate of close to around 7% per year. And we think that's likely to slow to an average of closer to 2.5% on average over the outlook, so a significant slowing. When trying to get your heads around about what's driving that, two things are driving that. One is just the pace of overall GDP growth in those economies will gradually decline over the outlook period relative to the last 10 years. In addition, the nature of that growth will become less energy intensive. Essentially, that process of rapid industrialization will start to mature. You'll start to get greater growth in the service sector, less within the industrial sector, and so that growth in GDP becomes less energy intensive. And as you can see here on the right-hand side, those two factors, slower GDP growth and sort of that growth being less energy intensive, explain roughly half each of this sort of overall slowing in the non-OECD energy demand, Asia's energy demand. So this sort of gradual coming of age of the Asian economies can be seen in the sectoral breakdown in terms of that energy demand, with growth in industrial demand, showing in that dark red swathe on the left-hand chart here, growing by around 1.5% on average over the next 20 years. So quite a bit slower than the 2.75% seen over the last 10 years. And this sort of coming of age, this process of slowing industrialization also has really quite material impacts for the fuel share shown here on the left-hand side, particularly for coal. So if you look at coal, which is the bottom swathe, gray swathe here, over the last 10 years or so, coal has been the fastest growing fossil fuel. And essentially, this is as coal essentially has surfed the sort of the Chinese industrialization wave. As China has grown very rapidly, the process of industrialization over the last 10 years has been very rapid, and as a result of which, demand for coal has been very rapid. Going forward, that process starts to slow over the outlook, and essentially we have China's consumption of coal plateauing in the last 10 years of the outlook. So between 2025 and 2035, China's consumption of coal broadly plateaus out. And as a result, coal, which has been the fastest growing fossil fuel over the last 10 years, we expect to be the slowest growing fossil fuel over the outlook period. So it's not quite the death of old King Coal, but like many of us, you know, coal's age is catching up with him, and it's likely to have to sort of take things slower going forward. Natural gas takes over the mantle of the fastest growing fossil fuel, helped by solid supply growth, and I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute, in addition to sort of supportive environmental regulation. If we take the fossil fuels together, so coal, oil, and gas, together they account for around two-thirds of the increase in energy demand. So energy demand increases by just shy of 40%. Around two-thirds of that is met by non-fossil fuels. So explained by fossil fuels. So fossil fuels continue to provide the majority of the world's energy needs. The remaining third is provided by non-fossil fuels, shown in those top sways at the top there, with renewables leading the way. We expect renewables to grow by close to around 6.5% per year over the next 20 years. So 6.5% each year for the next 20 years. So strong, sustained growth in renewables. And you can see that in that increasing size of the orange swathe at the top of the left-hand side. If you take those trends together, this chart shows the share of both fossil fuels and non-fossil fuels within total primary energy. And you see one of the striking features of the outlook, which has been a feature for the outlook for the last several years, is this clustering by the end of the outlook in the shares of fossil fuels within primary energy. So I sometimes refer to this as the sort of the 27% rule. There's nothing special about 27%, but what we're seeing here, what we expect to see, is that so the three main fossil fuels clustering in their shares are around between 26% and 28%. And if that does turn out to be the case, this will be the first time, I think, in economic history when you go back, there's not one dominant fossil fuel driving meeting the world's energy needs. So a more diversified portfolio in terms of fuels driving the economy. In terms of non-fossil fuels, shown at the bottom of the chart, renewables overtakes nuclear in 2020 and hydro in 2030 to be the dominant non-fossil fuel, with the share of renewables in primary energy increasing from around 3% today to around 8% by the end of the outlook. So underpinning this story of strong, sustained growth within renewables. When forming a view like this about what's like the evolution of fuels and their relative shares, perhaps the key sector to look at is the power sector. Now, in part, that just reflects the sheer importance of power in terms of its demand for primary energy. And so you can see here on the left-hand side, the share in the use of primary energy going to the power sector has increased pretty relentlessly over the last 30 or 40 years. And we expect that process to continue going forward as a sort of process of sort of this trend towards increasing electrification across the world continues, such that the share of energy going into the power sector by 2035 is well on its way to 50%. So by 2035, almost half of the world's energy is going into the power sector. So one reason for looking at the power sector is just its sheer size. In addition to that, what's special about the power sector is the fact that it's the one sector where all fuels, fossil fuels and non-fossil fuels alike, are able to compete together. And this right-hand panel here shows the different shares of fossil fuels within the power sector. And it sort of reads to me like a sort of little mini potted history of energy demand. So you can see, you can start, go back to the mid-60s with the dominance of coal. Then you see the increasing role played by oil. As oil, the importance of oil fades, that was then replaced by an increasing role for nuclear. And then more recently, that's been overtaken by the emergent greater share for gas. Over the horizon, we see coal continuing to lose some of that share, consistent with it being the slowest growing fossil fuel, with the big winner here, an increasing role for renewables, shown by that orange swathe. So if you step back, you know, so the other sort of key feature of what we're looking at is a far more diversified portfolio of fuels by 2035 in the power sector than we had previously seen at different points in the past. And it's that diversified portfolio of fuels in the power sector which is a key factor leading to that clustering I was talking about a moment ago in terms of the fossil fuels. Another important feature or interesting feature of the outlook, I think, is the growing importance of what, you know, perhaps we can loosely term new energy forms. And so by new energy forms, I'm talking about renewables together with shale gas and tight oil sands and biofuels. So these energy forms have been boosted in recent years by both improvements in technology, really substantial improvements in technology, together with relatively high and stable energy prices. And we expect that strong growth to continue over the outlook, with these new energy forms in aggregate growing close to 6% a year on average over the next 20 years. And in total, these new energy forms, we think, will account for around 45% of the total increase in energy supply. So I mentioned a moment ago, we think, when thinking about this overall increase in energy demand, how's that met on the supply side? One way of cutting that cake is saying around 2/3 in terms of fossil fuels, 1/3 in terms of non-fossil fuels. Another way of thinking about it is saying, well, around just less than half of it is in terms of these new energy forms, and just over a half in terms of more conventional energy forms, just when you're trying to think about how that demand and supply meet up. If we just focus for a moment, I want to focus for a moment on both just shale gas and tight oil. So the right-hand chart here shows current estimates, and at this point, and many people in this room will know far more than I do about this, but current estimates have to be in big sort of quotes, in the sense that those estimates are very uncertain and will change over time. But it shows current estimates of technically recoverable resources of tight oil, shown in green, and shale gas in red across the globe. And I wanted sort of to draw out 2 points from this chart. First, if you just focus on the North American bar, I'm just looking at North America. The first thing which is quite striking about this chart is the amount of recoverable shale gas, or estimates of the amount of total recoverable shale gas shown by the red bar here, is several times greater than that for tight oil. So the underlying resource base is quite significantly different for shale gas and tight oil. And that difference in the relative sizes of the resource base is key to our outlook for unconventional energy in terms of the development of unconventional energy within North America. So we think, in terms of shale gas, we think that resource base, it means that shale gas will carry on growing rapidly for almost the entire 20 years. So we expect to see growth of close to 5% in North American shale gas on average over the next 20 years. So strong growth within shale gas. In contrast, the smaller growth rate in tight oil means, although we expect to see some continued growth in North American tight oil over the next few years, that's likely to then plateau out over a period of time. So the very rapid growth rates we've seen over the last few years won't keep on being repeated throughout time. They'll start to see the plateauing out in the level. So to be clear, I'm not suggesting that US tight oil is going to fall away very rapidly. It's just not going to continue to grow very rapidly. We start to see a sort of plateauing out of the level. The second point I wanted to make is, based on these estimates of technical recoverable resources and what I was just talking about in terms of the profile for gas and oil, by 2035 for North America, we expect roughly around 50% of the tight oil resources and 30% of the shale gas resources to have been exhausted. So around 50% of tight oil, 30% for shale gas. The corresponding numbers for the rest of the world are less than 5%. So we don't see a big rollout of across the globe of the shale revolution over the next 20 years. And this is clearly one of those, this is a key judgment underpinning the outlook and the shape of the outlook. And it's based on the view that what we've seen in North America reflects a sort of a unique combination of both below ground and above ground factors, which just are unlikely to be replicated in any other part of the world. So in terms of below ground factors, in terms of the richness of the resource base and the ready access to water in many of those basins. And in terms of the above ground factors, there's a number of factors. I mean, I think to start with, to me, what's been really important is the sort of the nature of the political and regulatory structure in the US, which has fostered an industry which is not comprised of just one or two national energy companies, but is instead comprised of a very large number of some relatively small and medium-sized producers actively competing together, driving through quite incredible gains in efficiency and productivity. Add to that the nature of mineral rights, which facilitates the ready access to those resources, together with relatively low population densities in some of those resource-rich areas. And then the final thing I think about would be sort of just the capacity and expertise of the service sector in North America and the related infrastructure, which has sort of enabled this shale revolution to take place. If you then think about that sort of checklist, and then think about any other the other countries which have significant tight oil shale gas resources, it's just not many of them, any of them sort of really go close to ticking off those checklists of all those above and below ground factors. So given that, I think sort of the central case of a sort of limited rollout of the shale revolution across the globe, I think is a plausible and reasonable one. But we have to recognise that we've been repeatedly surprised by the strength and the vitality of the shale revolution. So quite a sobering chart for us at BP is if I look at the last 3 or 4 years of the energy outlook and look at our estimates of the growth of tight oil, and then just look at them on top of each other, the growth rates keep going pushed higher and further out. We've been consistently surprised by just how strong that growth rate is and how long it looks like it's going to persist. So it's quite possible that, you know, that we could be surprised again. The shale revolution may well be contagious. And so when thinking about the uncertainties surrounding the outlook, I think a key one is just how significant this rollout is across the globe. Our central case is very limited, but that's clearly a highly uncertain thing. That's what I wanted to say in terms of some of the sort of the key defining sort of big picture features of the outlook. And what I wanted to do now is look at two of the sectors in a little bit more detail. First, in terms of oil, and then I'll say a little bit more about natural gas. So in terms of oil, global liquids demand, by which here, so I'm adding together oil, biofuels, and other fuels, we expect that to grow by around 19 million barrels a day over the outlook to reach around 111 million barrels a day. That growth, you can see, is entirely accounted for by non-OECD, particularly China and India doing a significant amount of the work. Demand in the OECD economies, that peaked in around the mid-2000s, and we expect it to continue to decline over the next 20 years, essentially driven in large part by increasing efficiency of the vehicle fleet. So just to sort of, for those who aren't so familiar with these sort of numbers, an increase of 90 million barrels a day over the next 20 years is roughly equivalent to introducing another market the size of America. So it's quite a significant increase in overall demand for oil. How is that increase in demand for oil and liquids more generally likely to be met? We think it's likely to be met in terms of two waves in terms of the supply side. Initially, we expect there to be continued strong growth in North American supply, shown in that first lump bar. And then as that sort of growth rate in North American supply starts to plateau off, as I suggested, that baton of growth is passed across to OPEC, with strong growth in both crude oil and natural gas liquids, NGLs. Now, one of the joys of doing the energy outlook is, in the current environment, it gives you an excuse to not worry about what's going to happen to oil prices today or tomorrow or next week, but look ahead to sort of those big factors which are likely to drive energy over the next 20 years. That's what really matters for companies like BP when doing those big strategic decisions. And I think it's also what really matters for policymakers and regulators when thinking about how they wish to shape the energy market over that period of time. So, you know, I was hoping not to get dragged into long discussions today about what's going to happen today or tomorrow. But just to give you an idea of sort of what's the underlying assumptions in terms of how the current weakness play out in terms of the underpinning the outlook. Over the past sort of 5 years or so, and just going forward a little bit, we expect to see, you know, really strong growth. We've seen really strong growth in U.S. tight oil. That growth in tight oil, together with NGLs and other types of oils, have more than explained on the right-hand side the entire increase in the global supply of oil over this period of time. OPEC's crude production has actually declined over this period, driven in part by supply disruptions, but not by enough to stop the underlying weakness. Looking ahead to 2020 and beyond, we see, as I was saying, this slowing in the growth of US tight oil, so the yellow bar gets significantly lower, some growth in tight oil across the rest of the world, but relatively limited to what we've seen over the past in terms of the US. And instead, we see OPEC production starts to increase again, and what might be termed more normal market dynamics are restored. So what does that mean? I think the underlying story underpinning the outlook in terms of the current weakness is a story in which the oil market grows out of its current problem, its current weakness. So if you think about underpinning the current weakness, I think to a very large extent is the fact that we've seen very rapid growth in US tight oil. So US tight oil in the last 3 years has more than accounted for the entire increase in global demand for oil. That doesn't continue forever. Over a period of time, as I was saying, that growth in US tight oil starts to flatten out. As it does start to flatten out, global GDP continues to grow. And with it, global oil demand continues to grow. And after a period of time, global oil demand grows sufficiently to absorb this increased supply. So over a period of time, because US tight oil doesn't continue to grow rapidly forever, the market, the overall demand for oil will grow sufficient to absorb it, and sort of more normal market behavior is restored. That may well take several years to happen, but that's sort of the underlying story underpinning the outlook. In terms of OPEC, OPEC's market share by 2035 is expected to be around 40%, so similar to its average over the last 25 years. So what seems odd, every time I pick up a newspaper over the last few weeks and months, I see somebody reporting the near demise or the impending demise of OPEC. But based on this outlook, I think those reports are greatly exaggerated. Within this outlook, OPEC remains a central force within the oil market over the next 20 years. One lasting implication of what we're seeing in terms of the increase in North American production is the pattern of oil trade, with oil increasingly flowing from west to east rather than from east to west. So when when I was at school and growing up, I conventionally used to think about oil being produced in the Middle East, flowing to the west, to both Europe and the US. We think that over a period of time, that pattern of trade is likely to move in the opposite direction. Part of that is because there's an awful lot more oil being produced in North America than was previously the case. Part of it also reflects the fact that we expect to see increasing efficiency gains in both North America and Europe, so those demand comes down. And then, so in terms of America here, you can see in the yellow chart, in the yellow line on the right-hand side, or the green line on the right-hand side, U.S. is charting a course towards oil self-sufficiency by the early 2030s. At the same time, you can see the dependence of both China and India on imported oil is increasing. So as a result of which, these trends, both increasing supply in North America, declining demand within both North America and Europe, increasing demand within the Far East, that pattern of oil trade switching, instead of going from east to west, increasingly going from west to east. That's all I was going to say in terms of oil. I wanted to turn briefly next to natural gas and what we see going on in terms of natural gas. As I mentioned, gas is the fastest growing fossil fuel in the outlook, growing by close to 2% a year on average over the outlook. On the supply side, shown on the left-hand side here, that reflects strong growth in both conventional gas supplies, which is the sort of the big light green swathe at the top here, and we see that continue to grow quite strongly with growth in particular in terms of the Middle East and Russia. But we also see quite significant growth in shale gas, particularly driven by North America, which accounts for the vast majority of that sort of increasing pink swathe in the middle of the left-hand chart. And roughly, when you're thinking about the increase in overall gas supply, around half of it is explained by increases in conventional gas, and around half of it is accounted for by increases in shale gas. So roughly half and half. On the demand side, shown on the right-hand side, we see strong growth in both power sector demand and industrial demand, and that's helped in part by regulatory factors which encourage a switch from coal into gas. One of the, I think, most intriguing features of what we see going on in the gas market is that we expect to see a sort of rapid increase in the supply of liquid natural gas, LNG. That increase in supply comes in two waves. So the first wave happens over the next 5 years or so, where you can see there's a sort of growth spurt over the next 5 years or so. And so of the total increase in supply of LNG, we think around half of that is likely to come online over the next five years or so. And the story underpinning that is just based on our sort of detailed knowledge of all the different LNG supply projects which are currently in train or they've been approved, and they come to fruition over the next 5 years or so. In the early 2020s, there's sort of a bit of a pause as that increased supply has to be absorbed by increasing demand. But demand does increase, particularly demand from Asia, such that you get another sort of more steady growth, a more steady period of growth in the last 10 years or so of the outlook. As a result of this growth, Australia, shown in the blue swathe, together with Africa in the top yellow, and the US, all overtake Qatar as the dominant sources of supply for LNG. This increase in LNG accounts for the vast majority of the increase in traded gas over the next 20 years. So when thinking about traded gas rather than domestically produced, that can either come in the form of pipelines or in the form of liquid natural gas. And we think the increase in traded gas over the next 20 years will be, the vast majority of that will be accounted for by LNG, such that by the end of the outlook, we see LNG overtaking pipelines as a dominant form of traded gas. And I think if that does happen, that has potentially quite significant implications for a number of issues within the gas market. And I just wanted to just focus on just two potential implications of this increasing importance of LNG. The first is in terms of price dynamics within the natural gas market. The greater mobility of LNG supplies relative to pipelines means we're likely to see greater integration of gas prices in terms of global gas prices. Now, the cost of transportation, the fact that the transportation costs associated with moving LNG across different markets means there's still likely to be persistent price differentials across different global markets. So those price differentials won't be competed away. But the mobility of LNG, and in particular the ability of LNG to respond to price signals. So, you know, taken literally, as a vessel leaves the port, it can turn left rather than right if the price signals tell it to do that in a way that traded pipeline gas can't do. That ability for LNG to respond to price signals means we're likely to see far greater co-movement in global gas prices across the world. So in my head, the way I'm thinking about this is you'll see gas prices moving in a band. The width of that band is defined by these transportation costs, which won't get competed away. But the movements in the band overall will increasingly get driven by global market-wide factors. So something happening in one part of the world will have implications for other parts of the world because of the fact that LNG can respond to that. So as a result of which, sort of greater integration of global gas prices, increasing integration of global gas prices over the next 20 years. So that's one implication of this increase in LNG supply. The second one relates to sort of the greater diversification of supply for major gas importers, so for countries which are highly dependent on gas imports. So as an example of that, I'll look at here is a case of Europe. So Europe currently, in 2015, in the middle bar here, around half of Europe's gas is currently produced domestically, shown by the red bar, and around half of it is imported, with the vast majority of that imported gas coming by pipeline, shown by the purple bar, and of which the vast majority of that is Russian, is supplied by Russia. If we fast forward 20 years, we expect the nature of European gas markets and the sort of the fact that they're aging means the amount of which will be produced by domestic production will decrease, such that by 2035, Europe will have to import around 3/4 of its gas. The absolute amount imported via pipelines will increase, and so Russia, in our outlook, remains a dominant supplier of gas. But we also expect there to be a second significant source of supply in the form of this imported LNG, which by 2035 accounts for around a third of Europe's imports. So greater diversification for Europe, and as a result, reduced risk and perhaps an increased security that will bring about. So I think this increase in LNG, if it does materialise like we think, has quite significant implications for both how we think about global gas market in terms of gas prices and also some of these issues to do with energy security and dependence of particular regions of the world. That's what I wanted to say on gas. Just finally, I wanted to think about some of the key uncertainties underpinning the outlook. So when the nature of the outlook is it sets out our view of what is likely to be the most likely central path for the energy markets, but there are obviously huge uncertainties around that. And in the outlook, we focus on four in particular, summarised here: the possibility that GDP growth may be lower, climate policies may be significantly different, the current heightened level of geopolitical uncertainty, and the uncertainty of exactly how China's trends in China's electrification will develop. And for purposes of time here, I'm just going to try and focus on those first two and just say a little bit about the first two of those uncertainties. So we consider, first of all, low GDP case. As I mentioned, aggregate GDP growth, global GDP growth in the outlook, is driven to a very large extent by strong growth in China and India. So just to sort of get the sort of a sense of what we have in mind, in very broad terms, China is assumed to have an average annual growth rate of around 7% in this decade. That slows into an average growth rate of around 6% in 2020 to 2030, and around 4% in the final 5 years of the outlook. So 7.54 for China. The corresponding numbers for India are 6%, 5.5%, and 5%. But what we know, and this is highlighted, for example, in a recent paper by Lawrence Pritchard and Larry Summers, is this can't go on forever. China and India can't continue to grow forever at growth rates significantly higher than the sort of global norm. And there's considerable uncertainty for just how long this can continue, and it's very hard to form very strong views and priors about exactly how long this continue. So to get a sense of this uncertainty, we considered an alternative case in which China and India's growth slows more rapidly. And very roughly, we reduced annual growth rates in each of those decades by just a little over 1%. So for China's growth rate now, in this alternative case, averages close to 6%. Over this decade, slowing to around 3% by the end of the outlook. And so in terms of overall global GDP growth, in this alternative case, overall GDP growth on a PPP basis is just a little below 3% compared to 3.5% in the base case. So this is not an extreme scenario by any stretch of the imagination, but the impacts on the outlook are really quite profound. So what this chart does here is looks at the impact of this case relative to the base case for GDP in the orange bars, energy in the purple bars, and for the different fuels. And the impact is that the level of global GDP is around 13% lower than in the base, with GDP in non-OECD Asia around 25% lower. So crudely, we've knocked around 1% off of growth over 20 years, accumulates up to around 25% off of growth. That lower level of economic activity reduces total energy demand by 2035 by a little over 8%. Or put another way, energy demand over the outlook grows, as I was telling you, in our central case, energy demand in the outlook grows by around 37%. In this alternative case, that growth in overall energy demand is closer to 25%. So you're knocking off around a third. If you want to put that even more starkly, this reduction in energy demand is roughly equivalent to the energy consumption of the entire European Union by 2035. So the uncertainty, so as economists, you have to admit to consider uncertainty just how long China and India can continue to grow rapidly relative to the global norm. And that uncertainty has significant implications for the energy outlook. So that's one significant issue, uncertainty, to think about. The second key uncertainty I wanted to highlight relates to the challenges posed by carbon emissions and the possibility that this triggers significant policy actions. And to provide some context for that, I wanted to start with a chart which I found when I first came to this subject 5 or 6 months ago to really strike and helps me think through the sort of relative importance of some of these factors. So what this chart shows is a very simple chart. It shows that we expect the level of GDP to more than double, and shown by the orange line, over the next 20 years, as I said. That leads to an increase in energy demand, as I said before, of close to 40%, shown by the purple bar. And we think our best guess is that the level of carbon emissions associated with that is an increase in carbon emissions around 25%. And relativities are shown by this chart here. If you look at, I want to think about these two wedges shown in this chart here. So the first wedge shows improving energy efficiency. So how much energy is needed to be used to produce an extra unit of GDP? And you see we've got quite a significant improvement in energy efficiency over the outlook. GDP more than doubles, but that only requires an increase in energy demand of little less than 40%. When thinking about that improvement in energy efficiency, one way of thinking about that is from a micro perspective, so one can point to particular initiatives one expects to see in terms of improving energy vehicle efficiency, where we expect the pace of engine efficiency that rate of improvement to be even greater over the next 20 years than it has been over the last 10 years. You could also point to the improving efficiency of power stations. From a more macroeconomic perspective, there's a strong correlation between economic growth and energy efficiency. So part of that story is just the nature of the change in industrial structure as economies grow. So as economies grow, they tend to have less weight in terms of the industrial sector, an increasing weight of the service sector, and therefore that which is less energy intensive. But some of that is also a function of market forces. So as economies grow, the most efficient companies will tend to thrive, the most efficient sectors will tend to prosper, and as a result of which, the economy will tend to become more efficient and driving this improvements in energy efficiency. And so, and you can see, we expect that improvements in energy efficiency to continue over the outlook. The second wedge, so that first wedge is energy efficiency. How much energy do you need to drive an increase in GDP? The second wedge relates to carbon intensity. So for each unit of energy I use, how much carbon emissions, how much carbon is emitted? And you can see here, so that wedge here depends very heavily on the fuel mix. So if we, over the horizon, as we see gas gain share relative to coal, so improving cleaner use of fossil fuels, that helps. Another significant factor here is renewables. So if you remember what I was saying about renewables we expect to grow by close to around 6.5% per year over the next 20 years. That accounts for around half of that wedge. So when thinking about carbon emissions, clearly half of that wedge is really important. But you can see here, in terms of the relativities, that increase in renewables is not a game changer on its own. It just gives you sort of sense of the relative sizes of some of these mechanisms and what we can hope the role they can play. Bringing this back to the uncertainties this poses to the outlook, despite the improvement in energy efficiency and despite the improvement in carbon intensity, we still think carbon emissions will continue to grow and grow on a path which is significantly higher than most scientific consensus would be in a path needed to ensure that global mean temperatures don't grow by more than 2 degrees. Shown here for illustration by IEA's 450 scenario. So as such, under this outlook, policymakers at some point in the future may wish to impose more, may wish to introduce additional policies. When considering what type of options policymakers want to consider, my predecessor Christoph Ruhl, when he was presenting the Energy Outlook a year ago, sort of noted, slightly in passing, that a 1% shift in the mix between coal and gas would have the same impact in carbon emissions as an 11% increase in renewables in power. So just to get a relative size of proportion within the power sector, if you had a shift between coal and gas of 1%, that would leave you the same reduction in carbon emissions and 11% increase in renewables. And that just reflects the relative size of those bases. People liked this 1 to 11 ready reckoner. So what we've done here on the right-hand side is build in a number of other policy options which also have the same impact in terms of saving global emissions. So this is normalized around that 1% shift in coal and gas. You can see the renewables and 11% there, and I've just added in a number of other options which have the same impact, just to give people a sense of those ready reckoners. Some of those options relate to what we need to have and see greater improvements in energy efficiency, which I was talking about, that first wedge in terms of vehicle efficiency or the efficiency of power stations, and some of them in terms of how to get great improvement in that second wedge, that carbon intensity, like an increase in nuclear power. What we do in the booklet, and I haven't got time to today, we then say, just what would you need to do to each of those to reduce carbon emissions in 2035 by about 2 billion tonnes? So essentially, one-tenth of what needs to be happened. And then we look at what would need to happen to each of these options and compare them to sort of improvements we've seen in the past and also what we expect to see in our central case, just to give people a sense about what is potentially plausible. And I sort of drew, as somebody coming to this relatively fresh, two key conclusions from that analysis. First, none of these options on their own is likely to be sufficient to get anywhere near like the improvements we need to see. There's no silver bullet here. We need to make progress in a whole range of fronts, both in terms of energy efficiency and carbon intensity, if we're going to start to address this imbalance. Secondly, trying to work out now which of these options is likely to fly and which of them is likely to fizzle out is really difficult. So you've all heard a story, which I think is a perfectly legitimate story, about you get 10 economists in a room and they will come up with 11 conclusions. True. I can also report the same thing happens when you get 10 technology experts in the room. They can't agree on which of these are likely to really fly and which not. If they can't, asking policymakers now to do that is a really hard task. So given those two conclusions, I end up thinking, so those two conclusions in terms of need to make progress on a whole range of fronts, the difficulty of asking policymakers ex ante to pick winners and losers, it seems to me that when thinking about how to make progress, a key component of that progress will be policymakers taking steps to generate a sort of meaningful global price for carbon. A meaningful global price for carbon provides incentives for everyone in the economy to play their role. So big energy producers, but also likewise big energy consumers, also small entrepreneurs working within the renewable sector. They're all responding in that sense to the same mechanism and all have the same incentives to play their role. A meaningful global price for carbon would also allow market forces to play a greater role in allocating resources across different factors, depending on what the market thinks is likely to succeed or not. So you're not asking policymakers now to pick winners and losers. You allow the market and to choose and to allocate resources as knowledge increases. I've gone on miles too long, so let me stop and I just sort of conclude here, related, bring it back to sort of the near here and now, where we're in this period of sort of significant volatility, and sort of the temptation is to say, well, when will this all settle down and we go back to normal? But I think the point here is continuous change is a norm for energy markets. We've seen that consistently over the last 30 years. And what the energy outlook suggests is that change, that process of change, is likely to continue going forward. Changes in the energy mix, with natural gas replacing coal as the fastest growing fossil fuel, and rapid growth in renewables. Changes in the pattern of trade, with energy increasingly flowing from the West to sort of quench the thirst of the fast-growing Asian economies. And more change needed to ensure that everyone, energy producers, energy consumers, those in big and small, play their role in meeting the world's energy needs in a sustainable manner. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Spencer. A huge amount to cover there. We have about 35 minutes. I'll kick it off with a couple of questions up here, and then we'll open up to questions from the audience. I'm sure there are many. We already have questions coming in by Twitter as well. So again, people just joining us, you can submit your questions at ColumbiaUEnergy. The hashtag is CGEPEvents. And for those listening to the podcast in the future, to remind you, we're here with Spencer Dale, Group Chief Economist at BP, talking about their most recent energy outlook. I'm Jason Bordoff, the Director of the Center on Global Energy Policy. So I just want to ask you one or two questions on supply, and then on demand, and then on climate, and maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up to questions from everyone else. I know you want to think about 2035, not today, but I'm going to ask you one or two questions about not exactly today. I'm not asking you to predict exactly where the LLS Brent spread will land tomorrow. But just thinking a little bit further out about the dynamics in the oil market today and where you see it kind of coming into a little bit more balance in the near term. On the supply side, how do you see that playing out? You know, when the oil price first fell, there were the cover of The Economist, shakes for shale, and OPEC was trying to kill U.S. shale. There's a little bit of a sense now that shale, as you said, may work at lower prices. So in a lower price environment, wherever you want to put it, 60, 65, 70, how much, where does production start to come offline and over what time frame? How much is in the U.S. and how much is elsewhere, and where do you see it coming?
I'll sort of broaden that out of the question a little bit, and I'll get around to answering. I guess two points in general in terms of how I see the price dynamics, and then perhaps a little bit about what may be special or changing. So in terms of what I worry about a little bit, often the question is posed at these types of events is, how long will oil prices remain low? And the problem when somebody poses that question of how long will they remain low, is the sort of the implied inference is, when they stop being low, they go back to where they were before. And then, and this is often the debate at the moment where people are sort of debating the relative pros and cons of V's versus U's versus now W's as well. And the trouble with all those letters is they end up where they start from. And somehow the implication is $100 was a sort of a natural settling point. But, you know, for those of you who were present for the Energy Outlook launch a year ago, it was quite clear what we were saying then was those factors which were leading to oil prices being close to $100 and staying there were unlikely to persist as well. And so when thinking about where oil price is going to, I don't think the natural settling point is 100. The second point is, when thinking about how long this will last for, the natural frame of reference is, well, how long will it take for demand and supply flows to go back into balance. And then one relates then to, you know, what we all were taught in school in terms of demand curves being, both demand and supply curves being relatively steep, relatively price inelastic. So that's likely to take some time to take place. But the key point is I think getting to the point in which the flows get back into balance, I think is only halfway, means we're only halfway in terms of working out of this weakness. Suppose, you know, under a relatively, you know, I think optimistic scenario, by sort of beginning of next year, we start to get to a point where demand and supply are coming in flow terms more closely back into balance. At that point, you would be in a world where for well over a year, 18 months, each and every day, the supply of oil would have been about 1 million or 1.5 million barrels of oil would have been supplied each and every day more than anybody wants to consume. So you've got a really significant increase in inventories. And so the way I think about this problem, it's not a flow problem, it's a stock problem. And that could take equally easily as long again for that stock imbalance to work its way off, because you need for a period of time for demand to move over outside of sort of the flow of supply to get that demand, to get that stock imbalance to work through. So it's a sort of two-phase process. I guess the other thing which I'm sort of, I think is intriguing, and I think it's hard to know yet, when thinking about the supply side, we typically think about the supply curve being relatively inelastic because of the nature of large long-term oil projects, and tight oil has a different dynamic. The other interesting different dynamic is the nature, the exposure of tight oil, the need for that in terms of continuous flows of finance. So in a world where the majority of oil or sort of nearly all oil supply is being driven either by large oil companies or national oil companies, the dependence on sort of bank finance and continuous flow of finance is relatively limited. We're now moving to a world where, for that tight oil, that's far more dependent on continuous flows of finance, and particularly for bank lending. And so suddenly, a mechanism which we saw was really important within the financial crisis of bank lending starting to dry up and that having a significant impact on demand and supply, I think suddenly, potentially, when we're thinking about how supply may respond in the future, there's an extra dimension which hasn't been there before, which is sort of the role of the financial markets and financial imperfections and how that may act to also affect supply and demand.
Yeah, and so do you want to say another word on that? How I'm just wondering how you think that'll play out. I mean, you're here in New York City. How much does access to capital and leverage, how is that going to affect the ability of shale, even with improvements in productivity that we could be even greater than we've seen, to
So the genuine answer is I don't know, and I think we're watching along with everybody else, and I genuinely don't know. But an observation I made from my previous life, in central banking, I was on the Monetary Policy Committee during the financial crisis, and so sort of involved in that. And an example of what I observed in the UK, just to take this as an example, is at some point in time, one got the impression that many people in the UK banking system were saying, I'm not going to increase my exposure to the UK property sector. And either that's because my board has told me you're not going to increase your exposure to the property sector, or it's you saying, by golly, I'm not going to go to the board and tell them I've just increased my exposure to the property sector. And as a result of that, somebody comes along and makes a pitch, and they've got a really good business model. This is going to work. People go, no, I'm not going to play. So at that point, the economics of the underlying investment become less relevant. And the willingness and the appetite of banks, and in some sense, banks aren't always super sophisticated looking at each and every one. Sometimes they just say, I just don't want to increase my exposure to that sector. So suddenly in this, the way that this may play out is, at the moment, when I read the analysis, much of the focus is on exactly where the break-even rates are of different wells and different places and different things. That may be important. They may be equally important. It may be just the appetite of the financial system say, actually, in this environment, given what's going on, I may not want to increase my exposure there. And that may just happen sort of almost independent of the underlying economics of some of this. And so how this plays out, I don't know. But I think it's an extra factor which, in the past, hasn't been a significant driver of or a significant part of the sort of adjustment mechanism within energy markets.
And you said quite clearly the reports of the death of OPEC are greatly exaggerated. We'll need that supply looking out into the next decade. There's one question via Twitter from a student of mine, actually, about whether you think OPEC is making the necessary investments today to be in a position to meet the supply requirements you're talking about.
So I don't have detailed knowledge of each and of the investments in each of the OPEC countries. There's nothing I can't see. There's no reason for my to think that there's a significant shortfall of investment within OPEC. And to remember, OPEC accounts for 40% in terms of the flow of in terms of the share of the oil market, but they account for around 70% of sort of, I think, crude reserves, I think, if my memory serves. So their willingness to continue to invest, I think, is key. And I guess just broadening the question a little bit, when thinking about how the current situation is going to play out, the natural focus for everybody, and I can understand why it's a natural focus, is to focus on tight oil and what's going to happen in the tight oil. But if you think about that, that's 5 or 6 million out of a market of 90 million. And so there's a real danger that in terms of near-term dynamics, and I can understand why people are thinking about that, but in terms of 2, 3, 4 years ahead, what really matters is not what's happening here, but what's happening elsewhere, both in terms of within OPEC, but also outside of OPEC, in terms of investments by the majors and so on.
I want to ask about demand for a second. You talked about how through 2035 we're adding another U.S. worth of demand, right? An average of, I think, 800,000 barrels a day on average. Can you talk about the probabilities around that? The idea of peak oil that we're running out, you don't hear much talk about anymore. The idea of peak oil, that demand might peak, that at a certain point the price is high enough, the cost of alternatives becomes attractive enough, that whether driven by policy or technology breakthroughs, is it plausible to you to envision a world where demand for oil peaks and starts to gradually decline?
So what we've seen in the OECD is oil demand peaked in the mid in 2005 or so, has been declining since, and we expect it to continue to decline going forward. And I'm now going to do something I always promise myself I'm not going to do, is try and remember a fact which I'm now going to get wrong. I think it's true for the EU, for the European Union, where we've seen these declines most significantly. Their demand for oil in 2035 is as low as it was, goes back, it has not been as low as since the early 1970s. So by 2035, the declines we expect to see in the EU means their oil demand goes back to where it was in the early 1970s. And somebody will correct me if that number's wrong. So we do see significant improvements there. If you're thinking about the next 20 years, in terms of sort of the non-OECD, we expect to also see significant improvements in vehicle efficiency, and so that pushes you in one direction. But we also expect to see really rapid increases in terms of vehicle ownership over this period of time. And the way that clearly vehicle ownership is correlated with increasing incomes, but also there's some non-linearities in that relationship. And so this emergence of the middle class in China means, and China and India means, you can see really rapid increase in the vehicle ownership over this period of time. And so I think the idea that that trend will be offset by energy efficiency over 20 years, I think, is unlikely. But the sort of the general trend of improving energy vehicle efficiency in both the OECD and the non-OECD, I think, is really important.
There's in all these scenarios we're talking about, as you said, they're nowhere close to being what people think is needed to keep the world from potentially quite severe climate change impacts. There's one question that came in via Twitter about whether you think a carbon tax would be effective. So, but let me broaden it also to talk about, I took your comment to be government should try to avoid picking winners and losers, but I don't want to put words in your mouth, so you can describe it the way you want when it comes to things potentially like a certain target of renewables versus other things. But if we were to come anywhere close to, I don't even know, you tell me if you think 450 parts per million is even achievable anymore, but anywhere close to that, do you have a sense of what the mix of our energy supply would look like in that world? And based on what we know today, what how you think we would achieve that much lower carbon scenario.
So, good question. So, so in my previous life, I was a policymaker in terms of monetary policy, and it always sort of frustrated me a little bit that everybody else seemed to know my job far better than I did. And so I'm sort of, I'm now not a policymaker, and I'm quite keen to not sort of repeat that error there. So I think the contribution that we can make as economists working within the energy sector is to sort of point out, just use our analysis of to make a couple of key conclusions. One was this point that you need to make progress across a whole range of options, and just picking on one or two isn't sufficient. And secondly, trying to identify now which of those are going to be a winner and which one's going to lose is just really hard, just because you have to have, you know, the uncertainty about how this will evolve is very difficult. And so that seems to me, as an economist, what we know is an efficient way of trying to achieve that allocation is to do it via taking steps, whatever those steps may be, to achieve a sort of meaningful global price for carbon. And what steps precisely they should take, how policymakers should do that, and what that price should be, I think is not. I'm not sure I have any comparative advantage to do that. But it's sort of saying I find it hard to think if I look back in 20 years' time and we have been successful, or 30 years' time we have been successful, I think I'll be surprised if a meaningful global price for carbon is an important component of that.
Let me ask one more. A combined question on natural gas and on renewables, just to talk about the impact of the current price decline. So you talked about where you think LNG demand is going, and you talked about the projects that we already know are coming online. In a low, and we still have oil indexation in existing contracts, question about what new contracts will look like. How much of an impact do you think the low oil price has on projected demand for LNG and LNG trade? And then the second question is, what impact do you think the low oil price has on renewables and investments in efficiency looking out again into the next decade or so?
So I think in terms of LNG, in terms of that sort of first sort of growth spurt over the first 5 years, our sort of central view is that sort of in train, and everybody we speak to in the industry and involved in these projects is such that the cost of stopping those projects is so high. We think that all of them will then come on stream, and so on. They will sort of come on stream despite oil prices, oil prices being low. Further out, there's clearly what will happen further out will be, when you get to the second half and beyond of the outlook, that will be a function of what happens in terms of oil and gas prices. But in some sense, as I say, the central view underpinning our outlook is one where it may take several years, as I was saying, because you've got this stock concept to work through, but over the longer term, this current weakness works through, and so it doesn't persist further out into the, sort of, by the end of the outlook. In terms of renewables, I think it's...
Just on LNG, yeah. I know you don't want to share price forecasts, but in broad terms, the question of whether we'll see more convergence in North America, Europe, and Asia toward kind of a single global gas price.
So the way I think about it is this band concept is that you may see some sort of narrowing in differentials, but those differentials persist because of the transportation costs, and LNG doesn't get rid of those transportation costs. So there's persistent price differentials, but around those persistent price differentials in that band then moves up and down in unison depending on the global shock. So you do see an integration of gas prices, not in terms of competing those differentials away, but they're moving in unison in response to common shocks.
Okay. And while you're answering the renewable question, if you want to ask a question, make your way to the microphone so people can hear online, and we'll have people queue up here at this microphone.
In terms of renewables, our sense is in the near term that growth in renewables is being driven by and supported by both regulation and the existence of subsidies. And so in the near term, the impact of this increase, the low oil prices, is likely to have a relatively limited impact. And I think then, in terms of sort of the motivations for and incentives for working in that sector at the moment, I think the key factor then will be a function less of what's going to happen to oil prices today and tomorrow and next week. It's what do I think of the level of oil prices that are likely to be in terms of a long-term sense? What's my long-term expectation for oil prices 10, 15, 20 years into the future. If you thought what's happening now was going to be one with where this persisted sort of into the indefinite future, I think that could have quite significant implications on your incentives today. But if you have a one where you sort of share their central view that you get out 10, 15 years and you've grown out of this problem, then I think it has less implications for people's incentive to be working within the renewable sector now.
Got it. Okay. If anyone has questions, we come up and use the microphone here. Please. If you could just briefly identify your name and affiliation, please.
I'm Bob Williams from Princeton University. And I would like to ask you a question, a what-if question, relating to your projection of huge LNG exports based on shale gas in the United States. In the projections of demand for natural gas in the United States made by the Energy Information Administration, there are two factors that could be very disruptive here and lead to a significant increase in the demand for natural gas in the power sector in the United States. And one is if the regulations being proposed by Environmental Protection Agency for curbing carbon emissions in the existing power plants, if that survives the courts, that could give a big increase in demand for natural gas in the power sector. In addition to that, the projections made by the Energy Information Administration have probably significantly underestimated the demand for natural gas as a replacement for coal because they have perceived high sustained capacity factors for coal plants, which are highly unlikely after coal plants pass an average age of about 50 years, and the average age of U.S. coal plants will be 50 years in 2023. And so you can expect the capacity factors to fall precipitously. So those are two huge potential increases in natural gas demand for the U.S. power sector that are unexpected on a business as usual future at the present time. And my question to you is, how do you think that demand would play out against the demand for shale gas for LNG markets, and how would it affect the gas price in the United States?
Yeah.
So do we have enough?
So within our outlook, as I said, we have strong growth in North American shale gas over the whole of this horizon. So it's growing by 5% a year, close to 5% a year on average over the next 20 years. So it's an enormous increase. And in some sense, I think the simple, it's not meant to be a glib answer, but there's enough to go around to do both. So, somebody will correct me if I get wrong, I should have checked this number beforehand. I think very roughly, very crudely, of that increased supply of gas, around 2/3 of it finds a home within the US. And so the natural thing is to try and find a home within the US, and a big chunk of that is increasing role of gas within the power sector. Helped in part by so increasing competitiveness of gas relative to coal. So we see that. But that still leaves over around a third of it, which will go into the LNG market. Now, nobody's shaking their head, so I think that 2/3, 1/3 number is wrong. Right. If it's not, I'll tell you afterwards. But the sort of the general answer is we do see and we when we're doing our outlook, we include future policy changes which will also help to support and encourage a switch from coal to gas. So we do see those mechanisms and those trends you see going on, but that still leaves enough for the US to become sort of one of the top three suppliers of exporters of LNG as well.
Other questions here? I can keep going. We got a question also on. Sorry, did you have a question? I'm sorry. Okay, we have another one through Twitter, but I'll come back to that in a minute. Okay.
Hugh Patrick, Columbia Business School. The beauty of a 20-year forecast is you can assume markets and governments adjust, and so you don't have. And of course there'll be fluctuations, so you get a very reasonable long run. Projection. There might be a very low probability major shock that would make your projection wrong. when you think about it, what are the ones that scare you?
Yes, I think that's a good, and I think three. Two of them, and I mentioned all three of them, because I say I think the value of the outlook is not to say, look, my crystal ball is better than your crystal ball. It's to sort of say, look, this is a sort of coherent narrative to help all of us think through what is likely to happen. And let me be very clear about the assumptions, not because I think they're necessarily definitely going to be right. I'm sure some of them, I'm certain that some of them will be wrong. But for others then to say, look, I buy X and Y, but I don't buy Z, so I'm going to aim off some of your assumptions. And I think the three things which I think are sort of real big game changers potentially here are, first of all, the two I talked about. So one was those two uncertainties. One is we will find out, it turns out that growth in China and India, although continues to grow very rapidly, it slows towards a sort of industrialized mean a little bit more quickly than we expect, where quite plausible growth scenarios where economists, I think, would find it very hard to put a far greater weight on one rather than another have really material impacts in terms of the growth of energy demand going forward. A second one would be climate policies in terms of what form policymakers change and what they introduce, which is like got to have profound impacts for the energy outlook for both for fossil fuels and non-fossil fuels. And I think the third is that one I mentioned earlier, which was we don't see a significant rollout of the shale revolution across the globe. If that's wrong, and you know, in some sense, one can't do much in terms of what's given to us by nature in terms of the below ground factors, but many of those above ground factors are man-made. And so some of those factors, if there's a will, may well be able to be changed. And so suddenly that checklist may look more significant. And if we do see a significant rollout of the shale revolution across the globe, that again is a sort of a third game changer in terms of the outlook over the next 20 years. So I think it would be those three would be the ones where I can identify the big uncertainty. But as we all know, then there's the other one, which is one I'm not even realizing is there at the moment, and that's mostly the one that will come and bite me, which is always the case.
Let me just ask on climate, and then we'll turn to a question here. The role you see gas playing in sort of achieving more stringent climate targets, and you kind of put striking data up about how significant coal to gas switching can be relative to renewables, because it's just such a large number, and you're growing renewables off a smaller base, and that's why there are many people who think gas has a really important role to play in lowering emissions. And then other people, as you know, raise concern. There are many concerns, but one of them is sort of long-term lock-in, right? You're looking to 2035, but looking out to 2050 or beyond, absent carbon capture and storage technology, we have to ramp down gas use pretty quickly too. So I'm curious, given that, how you think about the role natural gas plays in the medium to longer term, and how we take advantage of the lower carbon benefit relative to coal, but also kind of stay on the trajectory people hope we stay on.
Yeah, and I come from a background where we used to forecast GDP and inflation 3 years ahead. So when I came here and they said, guess what, we forecast out to 2035, I went, wow, really? And now you're asking me to go look even further, which I find slightly nervous. So you sometimes hear people telling us a narrative of gas sort of being a key part of the transition phase, where as you move increasingly, you over a sort of long wavelength transition towards increasing use of non-fossil fuels. And in that transition period, you move increasing use of gas, because particularly gas relative to coal, because it is such a such a cleaner fuel. And I think that's sort of I find that sort of narrative quite compelling. Exactly what mix we end up with in terms of fuels and non-fossil fuels is very hard to know in sort of depending on in the different scenarios. But I do note under the IEA's 450 scenario, fossil fuels were still providing, in that scenario which is consistent with that, fossil fuels were still providing the majority of energy needs, even in that scenario. So this idea that somehow in the end, there's no fossil fuels, I'm not sure it isn't, it would be in my central, mm-hmm. Well, it certainly isn't in my central case.
Yeah. I think the IEA in their 450 part per million scenario had fossil energy in 2035 going from 80% to 63% of total usage. And then obviously it depends on assumptions around CCS technology too. There was a question over here, and then one.
Hey, Larry Seibert. I'm a private investor. Thank you for your comments. The one player that you haven't talked much about that seems to be the most challenged in here, given the trends going forward, and the one that could therefore cause some geopolitical turmoil, is Russia. Can you comment a little bit on sort of your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So in terms of supply, which is sort of the main sort of role of Russia here, in terms of Russian oil, we expect sort of the Russian oil supply to pretty much be maintained over the next 20 years. So it is pretty stable over the next 20 years. The impact, and that relates sort of underpinning that, is a couple of underlying assumptions. One is that we think the sort of the main impact of sanctions in the near term is to shift the nature of oil production within Russia, where absent the sanctions, there may have been greater investment in unconventional plays relative to conventional plays. But we think there, as a result of the sanctions, what we see is just more resources go into conventional plays, and the resource base is such that it's more than able to support that. We also have observed, in terms of just the near term, when thinking about incentives, just observing over time, the Russian fiscal regime tends to be very flexible. So as oil prices have moved, the fiscal regime has also moved to make sure that the incentives for producers to continue to produce remain. So it's tended to be far more sensitive or far more responsive than fiscal regimes in other countries. So for Russia, we see this sort of maintaining this level of oil production. In terms of gas, in terms of specifically Russian gas to Europe, we think of that as being largely demand determined. The supply capacity in terms of the pipelines which exist now are more than adequate to accommodate all of that increase in gas supplies going forward. So this is a demand determined story. And as I said, over this sort of 20-year period, the demands from Europe will increase. Some of that will be met by LNG, but the majority of it will be met by pipelines, and in particular from Russia. And so we see increases in gas production and gas supply, particularly going into Europe.
And again, there was one question through Twitter about how dependent Russian production is on Western technology and capital. So I just want to make sure I understood your answer. Even if sanctions remain in place, which now are targeted at unconventional, offshore, Arctic, the capital can shift toward, the investment can shift toward conventional, And Russia can still maintain its supply.
So the underlying central case, and as always, there's lots of assumptions underpinning that, and the uncertainties. But the underlying central case is that you get this change in the pattern. So relative to the case where the sanctions weren't there, more conventional, less unconventional. But there is the resource base. We're pretty confident is sufficiently large that they can carry on doing that. And so it affects the nature of the plays rather than the overall output.
And how affected is that by the oil price decline in Russia? How much has it changed there?
So as I say, and I think relative to some other countries, is that flexibility in the fiscal regime, where they respond, the fiscal regime is very responsive, so it keeps on making sure the incentives are there for the oil companies to keep on producing.
There's a question here. Yeah.
Frank Bamberg, I'm a private investor. As to alternative sources, what would you consider alternative sources of energy, and which ones do you expect the improvement, an increase on?
So, in the outlook, we have some analysis on sort of the competitiveness currently and how that will evolve over time for both wind and also solar. And our current analysis, based on both our own, both the economists, but also the many technology experts we have in BP, we think that for some onshore wind sites, that the onshore wind is already relatively competitive. that will improve over time. We see there's this process of learning by doing. And also, we expect over this period of time, increasingly solar by 2035 to be increasingly competitive in a world where there is a sort of carbon, there's a price of carbon around $40, which is what we've assumed in our base case. So, but so wind and increasingly solar coming forward. I guess this is not quite the question, but it's a sort of interesting feature as well. Is what future for nuclear energy as well? And in our story, we have the share of nuclear remaining pretty flat, but that reflects sort of two very contrasting trends. So nuclear capacity within most of the world declining as reactors start to be decommissioned and then they're not replaced by new ones, but nuclear capacity in China increasing very dramatically. So based largely on their stated plans, and the way I think about this, because I'm not an expert in this area, the way I think about this is that what underpins our assumptions and is consistent with their plans, it's equivalent to China introducing a new nuclear reactor every 3 months for the next 20 years. So it's just mind-boggling. I come from England, and it took, you know, the idea of a nuclear reactor, we normally have in public investigations and consultations for several years for one. The idea of doing 3 months for the next 20 years. Now, the interesting feature here, why I think this is potentially interesting, is for all these sort of new energy forms or the non-fossil fuels, there's normally a significant learning by doing process. So why does sort of wind and solar gradually become more competitive? Because there's a huge learning by doing. My understanding is, if anything, learning by doing the nuclear sector up to now has actually been negative. Things have got more costly as it's gone forward, and so you haven't had that learning by doing. I think the interesting question is, if China does this in really intensive program for the next 10 or 15 years, does that mean there will be some substantial learning by doing within China, which then may spill over into other parts of the world, and suddenly some of the sort of the central case here, which is you don't get significant changes elsewhere, is that changed by a sort of a learning by doing in China, which may then be able to be adopted elsewhere? Now, there's still obviously considerable political and other types of issues, but we may be a period where we get some learning by doing within nuclear as well.
Let me ask you for a quick response to a final question that's come in also via Twitter, which says, renewable energy has grown every year since 2011 at about twice the rate that BP predicted. I don't know if that's true, but that's what the question says. May well be true. So the question is, why is BP confident that renewables won't grow at a faster rate? Or it says at a low rate. I guess your annual rate is not that low for growth. It's off a small base, but still it's, as a share of the total, pretty small, even out into 2035. So the question is, why don't you think it might be higher?
Yeah, so this is 6.5% growth every year for the next 20 years. And obviously, when this is compounding up. So growing something when it's very small by 6.5% is relatively easy. Growing something which is getting increasingly bigger over and over again by 6.5% is, you know, is a key, you know, is a, becomes increasingly more challenging task. A key sort of, I'm not sure gas ceiling is quite the right sort of terminology, but a key factor which can affect the growth of renewables is the fact that initially, and for quite understandable reasons, they tend to have significant subsidies associated with them as well. And as they started, as they start to, at the beginning, as they need to gain scale, that makes significant sense. However, if those subsidies have to remain as significant going forward, then the fiscal cost associated with these subsidies starts to really mount up as these things grow 6.5% year after year after year. And so for this to actually happen, which underpins our assumption, is this increasing cost competitiveness we expect to see in some of the main renewable sector means that you can get this growth and at the same time the subsidies can gradually be phased out, so you don't hit this sort of fiscal glass ceiling of an unwillingness to keep on subsidizing ever-increasing amounts. So I think, you know, my reading of this is, this is a strong, sustained growth in renewables, and is not one. And sure, we may be wrong, but I read 6.5% a year for the next 20 years as a pretty impressive thing. Not anything to certainly not a sort of modest one.
Well, I wish we had a lot more time to, there's so much more to talk about, but fortunately, you not only have a global energy outlook, but a statistical review of world energy. So there are two reasons, at least, if not more, for you to visit Colombia each year, and obviously the energy world is changing really quickly, so there's gonna be a lot to talk about. So we look forward to having you back, and appreciate again your joining us here today. Please join me in thanking Spencer Dale.
Thank you.